honestly surprised WWE even considered bringing back the Backlash pay-per-view event after that absolutely horrible 2018 edition. But I'm even more surprised that it's taken place as the June pay-per-view instead of the WrestleMania Revenge pay-per-view like it was always supposed to be. Also, even despite the fact that the main event of this pay-per-view actually exceeded my expectation and delivered as a freaking awesome main event, I am adding 20 sins because of WWE stupidly labeling it as the greatest wrestling match ever before it even existed. Really makes loads of other great wrestling matches say, wow, am I a freaking joke to you? Also, way to be a bunch of jackasses calling Edge vs. Randy Orton the greatest wrestling match ever, which puts more increasingly exhaust and pressure upon both men. Even more so than anyone who ever faced The Undertaker when the streak was still alive. Also, I'm honestly shocked that the name Greatest Wrestling Match Ever was not put on for a show in Saudi Arabia, because that term sounds so Saudi Arabia to me. In hype up to the greatest wrestling match ever, WWE is showing footage of some of the best matches of all time, and for some reason, Hulk Hogan vs. Andre the Giant. Also, if you take out Hulk Slam and Andre, you have a completely forgettable and clusterfuck of a match. The only good thing about that match was the fucking body slam. Does anyone even remember what else happened in that match anymore? Because I personally don't. Also, wrestling matches aren't determined to be the best based on a single moment that happened. Nobody looks at Shawn Michaels vs. Undertaker at WrestleMania 25 all just because Shawn kicked out of a tombstone piledriver one time.
Once in a lifetime, end of an era.
Once in a lifetime, end of an era, and even greatest wrestling match ever are all forms of false advertising.
How did we get here?
Beats me. I'm assuming Vince probably just got bored or something.
Then you don't know me.
Ha, I get it. It's because you hear the words "you think you know me" in Edge's music. A big wah-wah moment.
The greatest performers of all time.
Sorry, but by this point, there are way too many wrestlers in this world, past and present, who could easily be labeled as the greatest performers of all time. There's never just one or two anymore. Also, we've only just started what could be the greatest sins video of all time. Oh no, it's attacking me too! And I don't ever want to hear the words "greatest of all time" for the rest of 2020.
Backlash.
Well, thanks for making me tilt my head to the side. I think I heard my neck crack doing that, assholes. Alexa Bliss's Miss Pac-Man CGI graphics are creepy enough, but to add Nikki Cross into the mix just made it even worse.
Here she comes!
Corey Graves is a dick to Nikki Cross. The correct term is "here they come." I know Corey loves to see Alexa coming alone, but he's gotta realize that Nikki is coming with her too. That's what tag teams do. They lend a hand and come together at the same time. Poetry! Wait, why is my fanbase laughing at me and saying that's what she said? Clearly, this girl either doesn't want to be here or wants to exact revenge on Alexa Bliss or Nikki Cross for something we may never know happened.
Sasha, Bayley, we are-
Holy shit, this is the third pay-per-view in a row where Sasha Banks and Bayley are being interviewed just prior to their entrance. It's as if Kayla Braxton is determined to stop at nothing to make sure these two eventually turn on each other.
Introduce us properly.
But Kayla's not even the ring announcer, unless Bayley is looking to hire her to be the personal ring announcer for her team.
The best women's tag team champions ever.
Not really impressive when there's hardly a lineage to the women's tag team titles at all.
Bayley Dose Straps.
Bayley Dose Straps sounds just as bad as Becky Two Belts, which for the record only work because Becky and Belts start with the same letters.
Will you lose your friendship with Sasha Banks?
How has Bayley not kicked her ass yet? Third consecutive pay-per-view where Kayla has asked about Bayley and Sasha breaking up. If this doesn't go anywhere, what's the damn point?
Well, it's boss time!
Which definitely means that it's sin time! I've been sending Michael Cole's boss time catchphrase for years. I can do this all day. Also, after many years of being a team, how does Sasha Banks and Bayley not have their own tag team entrance theme? It's been how many years now?
That I lose my friendship with Sasha.
This interview is still going on! And that one moment when you realize that Bayley being interviewed has more attention than Sasha Banks making her entrance.
Look in the mirror and tell yourself how stupid you are for even asking that question.
Nah, Kayla doesn't need to ask herself how stupid she is for asking that question. She needs to ask herself how stupid she is for asking that question in three consecutive pay-per-view events.
What if Sasha and Bayley do lose tonight?
And now Michael Cole is asking that question. Y'all are not just making it obvious that these two are going to eventually break up and turn on each other in an upcoming feud. You're overdosing it just as much as you're overdosing Edge and Randy Orton being the greatest wrestling match ever. Shut up already.
WrestleMania. They're great.
Nikki Cross is unintentionally twerking at the audience behind her. You didn't think I noticed that, did you?
There'll be three women in the ring at one time.
That's the proper way to perform a triple threat tag team match, not some bogus bullshit about only two wrestlers in the ring with one entire team on the outside. Thank you! Bayley stupidly trying to hand over her SmackDown Women's Championship to the referee so he can raise it up. Imagine if he actually said, all right, this match will also be for the SmackDown Women's Championship, meaning if Sasha and Bayley lose their tag team titles, the winning team would also get the women's title. The match has begun, and the first thing Billie Kay does is start taunting Alexa Bliss, who's not even the legal wrestler on her team. Well, it's clear that the Iconics aren't winning this match based on their stupidity to take their eyes off the prize early on.
This matchup, and Billie tag was not made. And
I'm adding in three sins here because Billie clearly tagged in Peyton Royce, and you heard the referee call for it too. But somehow Billie is still the legal wrestler going forward. Not even a minute into this match, and a bad call was made. We have a standoff with all three teams, but now that I think about it, this is a triple threat match, which means there are no disqualifications, which also means the referee is powerless to do anything about a potential brawl with these six women.
If someone dethrones Bayley, Sasha would love to throw her name in the hat.
Or maybe Sasha Banks would be the one to dethrone Bayley. You can't forget about that possibility, Corey. By leaping in the air to avoid Peyton's trip, Sasha is clearly focused. But when Peyton is going for a kick, the focus went right out the window.
From behind, Peyton Royce.
It's hard to tell if Alexa Bliss was trying to break up the pinfall or put herself over Sasha Banks, which would mean that she'd be the one pinning her. That would have been the perfect strategy to sneak a victory. Damn! Also, nearly 2 minutes of non-stop roll-ups.
Teams all need to be careful not to get themselves disqualified.
But you can't get disqualified in a triple threat match, Corey. You work for the company. You should know how the damn rules go for these types of matches. I don't work for the WWE, and even I know how this works. Then again, this is a company that believes referee stoppages is a legit finish for Hell in a Cell matches.
She stepped out of the ring. Oh!
Alexa could have done a variety of different moves. A kick, a punch, a shoulder tackle, or squash Peyton and Sasha. But the move she picks is a slap that doesn't even come close to connecting with Peyton's face. Bayley's cringe attempt at an Australian accent. I get that you chose to team up with Billie for the time being, but the accent attempt wasn't necessary.
It's truly
Iconic, mixed with a waste of time pose.
Nikki Cross.
How about less complaining on how you almost had the match won and more focusing on getting the match won? Deal? Good.
Here's the roll-up on it.
Another three sins added because the referee clearly did a fast count on Alexa to give Sasha and Bayley the victory. Maybe what Bayley told the referee earlier was count fast when one of us gets the victory and secretly paid him. Sneaky move. That Braun Strowman felt awkward knowing a random guy was filming outside just waiting for him to show up in his car. Also, 45 seconds of watching Braun drive up, park his car, and then go about his business. Unless The Miz and John Morrison were going to do anything to him, what was the point? It took WWE literally all the Extreme Rules events before they decided to make a reference to Team Extreme with the pay-per-view's logo, and personally, I preferred the other one.
You're just a junkie.
WWE asked, how do we set up a feud with Jeff Hardy? And the answer was to recreate his rivalry with CM Punk from 2009, except make it less entertaining and more irritating.
You're gonna have to take a urine test.
Man, WWE is not only recreating rivalries from the past, they're also remaking scenes that they've done in the past as well. They're determined to hang on to the past as long as possible. You didn't become a successful company by hanging on to the past, you know. Yeah, I know the piss is fake, but I'm just saying, if Jeff Hardy's pee looks like that, he might have more than just a drinking problem. I may not have enjoyed this urine test segment, but damn, Sheamus really knows how to sell this. That expression was epic.
Here tonight, he understands.
Plexiglass fist bumps. Sheamus is non-pyro-pyro, and in a small performance center, nobody's going to have pyro anyway, so why bother with the noises?
To put the Celtic Warrior away.
I bet Sheamus is realizing that, just as he managed to get rid of the You Look Stupid chance by growing his hair back, he now has to deal with another chant in You Got Pissed On. This guy can't seem to catch a break, can he?
Clear power advantage out of the-
Early on in the match, Sheamus is determined to make sure that Jeff Hardy's face paint suffers his wrath. Seems to me like Sheamus has a bigger vendetta with the face paint than he does with Jeff himself. That hypocrite Sheamus telling Jeff to think about him and his family, all because Jeff threw his piss on him. After everything you said about Jeff and his family, why the hell should Jeff give a shit about your side?
And he wants to punish Hardy.
Michael Cole is reprising his role as Sherlock Holmes for the whatever 100th pay-per-view in a row. Oh, great.
Poor Corey, really?
Heel wrestler blames the fans for whatever he's going to do to the good guy in a match cliche, which most of the time doesn't make a lot of sense.
He looks better than he ever has in the past couple of months.
Actually, Sheamus looks better than he ever did since 2015.
You can not risk disqualification here.
Honestly, why not? First of all, Sheamus continuously poked fun at Jeff's legal troubles over the years and insulted his family. And secondly, it's not like this match is a championship match or the winner gets a championship match. If Jeff gets disqualified, what would he honestly lose? What he would gain is the chance to kick Sheamus' ass more than he ever could in this match.
Hardy yet again. Oh my.
It's hard to tell if Jeff Hardy failed to counter or if Sheamus didn't throw Jeff at the right moment. Either way, someone failed.
You're all enablers!
Good lord, Sheamus really is a discount CM Punk in this rivalry. At least Punk made the rivalry with Jeff's legal issues worth tuning in with our eyes fixed on the screen. Sheamus would be great at CinemaSins 2 expansion. About time someone told Michael Cole to learn how to commentate properly. Where was Sheamus when Michael had a creepy erection for The Miz 10 years ago? Something I never understood is why low blows are illegal, but only if it's a punch or kick. Meanwhile, if you intentionally hit a leg drop on your opponent's balls, which in turn causes the same effect as a low blow, nothing to worry about whatsoever. Also, Jeff Hardy's a dick to Sheamus' Celtic Warriors. Commentator stupidly refers to a roll-up as stealing the victory cliche. Y'all really want to push all the cliche buttons tonight, don't you?
Is it time to fly?
Yes, it is time to fly, but yet Jeff Hardy is doing anything but fly. He's in perfect position to hit the Swanton Bomb on Sheamus, but just stays perched so that Sheamus can quickly recover and counter. Stupid.
And Sheamus realizing that Hardy has an injured knee.
Okay, so Sheamus realizes that Jeff has an injured knee. So in order to exploit said injured knee, Sheamus' plan is to stomp on his arm? I'm sorry, but how does stomping on an arm hurt an injured knee? I'm 90% sure this scene and submission is meant to be a pun, but since Sheamus is Irish and the submission he has locked in is a cloverleaf.
And at this point, the official should...
The fans chanting Hardy in the slow way the Ewoks were chanting for C-3PO being a god in Return of the Jedi was fucking hilarious. Second pay-per-view in a row where the WWE talent recruits performed creative and funny chants related to Star Wars. If this shirt that Jeff wears is easily breakable with a simple tug, then what's the point of even wearing it in the first place? Catching Jeff in midair with that bro kick was an awesome way for Sheamus to win this match. Goes back to Jeff taking risks even when the risks aren't necessary. You could clearly see Jeff's shoulder rise off the mat before the referee completed the three count, yet the referee ignored it and finished him off. What an asshole. Just saying, you only lost a simple match to Sheamus. It's not like Jeff lost his entire career or anything. Kinda overreacted a little bit here. It's not the end of the world.
Preparing to be co-universal champions.
That's not how handicap matches work, Miz. Did you not see how Sami Zayn won the Intercontinental Championship alone instead of being co-champions with Cesaro and Shinsuke Nakamura back at the Elimination Chamber in March?
I'd much rather have you be universal champion.
Yeah, I'm having a lot of trouble believing that John Morrison, a guy who has never held a world title of any kind in WWE, would be totally fine with letting The Miz, a guy who has held a world title in WWE, winning the Universal Championship in this handicap match.
Is in these hands.
Get these sins, or in this case, one.
I might cash in.
And just by saying that, both The Miz and John Morrison can breathe a sigh of relief knowing Otis is not even going to cash in tonight. By alerting that you might do that, Otis just gave away the fact that he won't. Also, what happened to your little plan to cash in on the SmackDown Tag Team Champions to win them with Tucker, huh?
You may not be Universal Champion for very long.
Mandy Rose literally repeating the same thing Otis just said in a different way was absolutely hard to watch because WWE is trying to make her play the dumb blonde role. Crap, I think Nia Jax just injured my sin counter.
You were literally handed the Raw Women's title.
Nia Jax is wrong. Every fan who says Asuka was literally handed the Raw Women's Championship is wrong. Since the Money in the Bank ladder match was for the championship, that means Asuka literally won the title. So shut up with the stupid she was handed the title like Randy Orton at No Mercy 2007 bullshit. It's wrong and you're wrong.
Nia Jax!
Asuka, right infringement. And to be honest, seeing Nia Jax wearing Asuka's makeup looks increasingly disturbing. If she had a different gimmick with that type of face paint, it might actually work, but that's in a fantasy. More of those CGI graphics. Still struggling to fit into this tiny performance center, squeezed in together.
Oh, Nia Jax is jealous of the accomplishments of Asuka.
I failed to see what the problem with that was. Asuka is the first to have won every major accomplishment in the women's division, including all singles titles, the tag team titles, the Money in the Bank, and even the first ever women's Royal Rumble match. So who wouldn't be jealous of Asuka?
Going for the left arm, oh, and a big...
Nia punches Asuka in the arm, who responds by clutching her jaw, which was not hit in that exchange whatsoever.
Oh, it's in deep, deep, deep.
Samoa Joe saying deep, deep, deep.
She expected to come back here and immediately win the Raw Women's Championship.
And then Nia Jax realized that's not how getting title matches work when you return from injury, unless you were forced to relinquish the championship prior to your injury. I'm assuming this was Nia practicing the jackhammer to see if she could perfect it and use it in her arsenal under the name Jax Hammer. Wouldn't recommend it. Nia Jax making the big mistake of taunting the once undefeated and dangerous Asuka by bringing up Kairi Sane. Very, very bad idea, just so you know. I will admit that Samoa Joe is doing a hell of a good job on commentary with the way he delivers the names of the moves performed by Nia Jax and Asuka. Good thing we got someone like him around. Kick-ass move, but the problem with this is Asuka can't win by submission on the outside. Sure, she would retain her title if counted out, but trying to win by submission on the outside in a traditional wrestling match is really stupid. This match ended in a double countout, only for there to be a rematch the following night on Raw with an actual pinfall result. Makes me wonder why they didn't just do that tonight if the delay to a match victory was only for 24 hours. I'm adding in 5 sins because not only was the Raw Tag Team Championship match announced as an impromptu title match, but they hyped it up only for it to never happen at all. Sure, we got a hilarious cinematic brawl, but if that was always going to be the plan, then why not just do that without announcing an actual match in the ring? I'm sorry, but the greatest wrestling match ever is not to happen for another hour and a half, so what's the point in hyping it up right now?
Make it 30 bottles of the best champagne that you guys carry.
MVP pre-ordering champagne, not even realizing that there's still a 50-50 chance that Bobby Lashley will win the WWE Championship tonight. If I were MVP, I'd wait until after Bobby wins the title to begin the celebration. Otherwise, what the hell are we gonna toast to? Also, why 30?
And it's because of me that he is this successful.
Lana's really struggling to stay relevant in the WWE ever since Rusev walked away. Don't even try, it's not gonna work. Good God, 2020 really is a crazy year full of stress and frustration. This is the second pay-per-view where Braun Strowman is defending a singles title in a freaking handicap match. Why do they keep doing this shit? It's not cool. Also, with the added fact that only one member of Miz and Morrison can win the Universal Championship, that just made it obvious who's actually winning this match. As much as I didn't find this match enjoyable, the one thing I loved was the constant pranks performed on Braun Strowman, especially this accident with Kayla Braxton getting slimed. Also, hey, if she ever tries to ask Bayley or Sasha Banks about their friendship possibly ending, she can get slimed again as a reminder to stop asking that question. Winner of WWE Backlash 2020 to bring you The Last of Us Part 2. Oops, spoiler alert. I get that the slow motion sequence of Miz and Morrison's entrance was just slowed down footage, but if you want to make it look like they're actually in slow-mo, don't show them almost in the ring of the next camera shot.
Braun Strowman may be considered an underdog.
Braun Strowman? An underdog? Yeah, freaking right. The combined weight of Miz and Morrison pretty much equals or is close to Braun's size. 3 minutes of a music video. I gotta remove a sin for that. Adding in a train wreck and a blockade to Braun Strowman's entrance was awesome. Not to mention it was cool to see that interrupt Miz and Morrison video.
Interrupted the biggest video premiere since Thriller.
Corey Graves believes that Miz and Morrison's Hey Hey Something Something Ho 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 music video is even remotely close to touching the legendary video that is Michael Jackson's Thriller. Also, be careful, Corey. We managed to put away Michael Cole's creepy erection for The Miz after years of torture, and we don't need you resurrecting it from the dead.
Did you hear what they said about Braun? I feel bad that he did that till he was 6 years old.
Corey trying to bully at Miz and Morrison, claiming Braun Strowman used to wet the bed until he was 6 years old. That shit happens, man. I wet the bed until I was 25 years old, and I'm only 24!
Friend and partner John Morrison.
Braun Strowman somehow fell for that. Wow.
Strowman to lose the Intercontinental title!
Good thing that John Morrison fell back to get out of the way from Braun's big boot. However, even if he stayed put, Braun would have missed him anyway. Braun was too far away to successfully kick John regardless of the counter. The Miz is, let's hope Braun doesn't hear that I have been wetting myself and or the bed longer than he has face.
And Miz went with
damn, just like earlier with John Morrison, The Miz hits a big boot that never comes close to Braun's face. What makes it worse is Braun is somehow affected by that kick. Here is a double sin.
Back up to the apron, John Morrison looks to take advantage.
Oh, come on! Braun was clearly looking in John's direction even before John could leap onto the second rope to hit the flash kick. Another double sin.
Morrison has won 5 Intercontinental Championships.
Wrong, Michael. John Morrison has only held the Intercontinental Championship 3 times in his career. Twice as Johnny Nitro, and once as John Morrison. Did he win those other 2 IC titles in Appleton? Because I don't seem to recall him ever being a 5-time Intercontinental Champion.
To win the Universal title, meanwhile...
I get that Miz wanted to be the one to pin Braun and become the Universal Champion, but unlike you, John Morrison has never once been a world champion in the WWE. Would be more fair to have John be the one. Also, I thought you two didn't have a problem with one becoming the Universal- Nah, who am I kidding? This strategy never works. Everyone wants to be the champion.